man I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly. Why did she have to go? I don't know. You wouldn't say.
Oh, that was lovely. Thank you so much. Just lovely. Yeah, we're all kind of dreaming about yesterday when we could meet in person. Oh, thank you guys so much. Thank you.
Chris Myers has been a reference librarian at Lake Oswego Public Library for 3 years. A Portland native, Chris has a bachelor's degree in history from Stanford University and a master's degree in library science from Simmons University. Before moving to the Lake Oswego Library, he was the high school librarian at Oregon Episcopal School for 14 years. He likes to read all genres, fiction and nonfiction, sit on his porch in Southeast Portland while reading those books, get exercise, bake pies, and cook whatever Sam Sifton of the New York Times tells him to cook. Shannon Sedell has been at the Lake Oswego Public Library for 6 years and with the reference department for 4. Also a native Oregonian, she received a BA in art history from the University of Oregon and eventually found her way back to her first love, researching in libraries, graduating from San Jose State University with a master's in library science. Although she reads widely, she is partial to diverse and inclusive happily ever afters, having founded the library's romance genre book club and podcast, A Bookish Affair. Shannon is a lifelong reader, knitter, walker, baker, cat lady, and a general lover of food. We welcome Chris Myers and Shannon Sedell.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for having us. My name is Chris Myers.
And I'm Shannon Sedell.
And as Joyce said, we're reference librarians at Lake Oswego Public Library. You might be wondering, how did we get these two librarians? Well, Shannon and I are the two reference librarians who work Sundays through Thursdays. So it's a Sunday and we're on, and we're really glad that we get to talk to you about online library resources. So happy Labor Day, and Shannon and I are sitting literally like a mile apart from each other in our houses in the Hawthorne Corridor of Southeast Portland, but thanks to Zoom, we can be here together on screen with you, and someday we'll be together at the library again with nice patrons like you guys. I'm going to share my screen here. So our theme is that the library is open, sort of. We want to help you get as much as you can out of all the services we're offering, both online and somewhat in person. And this is what we're going to talk about today. And please, introductions we've already done. We've got some hot tips from Shannon and me, the librarians. We're going to talk about downloadable ebooks and audiobooks. We're going to talk about streaming video and audio content. Sources for information on things like genealogy, consumer ratings, newspaper articles, and then the kind of catch-all of other things the library does, like online programs and online book clubs. And then we want to take your questions, and hopefully we have answers for them. If you really give us a stumper, then we'll like get your information and get back to you, because we do like to look things up and give you good information. As was mentioned, if you have a clarifying question in the course of our talk, please feel free to stop us, and I don't want to go too far into things and confuse you too much. So I know you're really eager to hear the hot tips from the librarian, so here they are.
We encourage you to get as many library cards as you can. As a resident in the Portland metro area, you can get library cards to Multnomah County, Washington County, Clackamas County, and Fort Vancouver Regional Library for free. They are individual county systems, but because you live in the Portland metro area, you can do that. And so we recommend getting as many library cards as you can, because they all have online card options. They all have remote learning options, 24-hour library features, and they all just have a little bit different collections. So it's so much fun to check to see what kind of databases they have, as well as if Multnomah County doesn't have a particular author, but maybe Washington County does. So it's worth checking all of that out.
Number two, as the title of our presentation implies, we're open, sort of. We're still providing and rolling out gradually some in-person services. So I think every library in the Tri-County area is doing some form of curbside holds pickups. If you, like me, really like to read actual books, you can make an appointment and pick up those books. Most library or DVDs or Library of Things objects. Most libraries have wireless printing available from their parking lot, and you send your job from the comfort of your air-conditioned car, and then call us and we'll run and grab your job off the printer and bring it out to you. I think Lake Oswego might be the only library in the area that's doing this, but we also have at our library 3 hours every day, Monday through Saturday, two tents in the parking lot providing in-person services, a youth services tent and an adult services tent. And those have browsable books and DVDs and audiobooks, but also we have librarians staffing those tents to help you with any questions you have. So just be aware, we're not completely closed up.
When you have time, take a tour of your library's webpage. There's so much to discover there, from what some of, like Oswego Public Library has a remote library page, which kind of tells you what's going on, whether it's virtual events or various different resource lists to find. So definitely take a tour of your library's webpage. There's so much to discover, from databases to collections to groups to local history. There's so much. So it's worth taking a tour of that webpage.
Okay, we're all spending a lot of time on our computers these days, and getting to know your browser. And we encourage you to use your bookmarks or favorites bar if you don't already. I'll show you how I use mine, and if you want to imitate that or figure out how to be more efficient using your browser, you can do that.
Chris, we're doing fine. Just
okay. There's the last one.
It's the morning.
The final tip: when in doubt, call the library reference line. At Lake Oswego, we do have people, real people, on the phones from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Saturday. And you can talk to me later today on Sundays, 1 p.m. to 5 p.m. Definitely give us a call. We would be happy to either troubleshoot or help you locate something, you know, clarify some of the stuff that we've talked about today even. So when in doubt, call your library reference line. We'd love to hear from you.
Yes, and I am the Tuesday person. So from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m., I'm right here in my basement getting all the reference calls forwarded to my cell phone. So we hope we'll hear from you when you need help. So you only get three slides of PowerPoint. I'm sure you'll be relieved to hear. I'm going to exit this screen share and share my browser now. Okay, this is the Lake Oswego Public Library homepage. If you are a patron of Lake Oswego Public Library, I would recommend that you favorite this or bookmark this. I mentioned the favorites bar before. You can see mine up here, and it's just packed with these little logos representing things that I use a lot. And so I have the Lake Oswego Public Library, the Clackamas County Catalog, the Multnomah County Library, the Washington County Library, and then my 82-year-old mother makes use of the Oregon Talking Book and Braille Library, so I've got that quick linked as well. So how do I put things up there? And again, this may be review for many of you, and I apologize for that, but it might be something new for some of you. So if I go to Google and I search for the Lake Oswego Public Library, and I get to the website. Now it's here, and I know I'm going to come here a lot, and I don't want to go to Google every time I want to go to the Lake Oswego Public Library. So there's two ways I can do this. I can either click on the little star to the right, and that'll add it to my favorites bar, but it'll put it at the end of the list. Or I can grab this little icon and drag it over where I want it. Okay, oops. Hold on. Weird. Drag it over and drop it in, and then you can see it's taking up a lot of space in my favorites bar with words. So I'm going to go to edit and take out the words, so I only have the little icon. And now I have a link there, and you can see I have two, so I'm going to delete one of those. Okay. So that's how to use your favorites bar if you don't already. Now I'm going to talk about downloadables. When we say downloadables in the library world, we're talking about ebooks and audiobooks. And especially now during the pandemic, when people are having a hard time getting their hands on print books, and you can't always afford to buy one from an independent bookstore, and sometimes the hold lists are really long to get hot books. So you may be someone who likes ebooks and audiobooks, and you can get those through your library. For ebooks and audiobooks, we have two platforms in Lake Oswego. I'm going to talk about Overdrive, and Shannon will talk about another one called Cloud Library. And they're here under ebooks on our page. And Overdrive is the biggest company in this sector of library services, and it goes by different names. It's also, some people call it Libby. That's an interface on top of, laid over the top of Overdrive. And then in Oregon, we have a consortium that works with Overdrive to make these as affordable as possible for public libraries, and that's called Library to Go. So if you hear Libby, Overdrive, or Library to Go, that's all the same thing. So you can see when I click on Libby, it takes me to Library to Go. And I'm gonna sign in here. This is the Overdrive website. If you are really heavy consumer of downloadable ebooks and audiobooks, you're probably going to use your smartphone or your tablet, and then you'll download the Overdrive app onto your device, and you'll also probably download the Cloud Library app, so you have as many options as possible. But you can also interact with it here on their website. This is the Oregon's Overdrive website. So I'm going to sign in with my library card. You can see it defaults to libraries in Clackamas County. get signed in here. And they curate some lists around topics like anti-racism. There's Libby again. They really want you to put Libby as your interface. Series, books, apocalyptic reads. I'm not sure any of us really need any more of that right now. Audiobooks that you can get right now. And if you notice that the books with a green stripe on the top of the cover are available. If they have a white stripe, that means there's a wait list and you can get on the hold list. So for example, I really want to read this new book, Hamnet, by an English author, Maggie O'Farrell. And you can see I want to get the audiobook. It's got a wait list, so I'm going to put it on hold here. And now I am number 21 on the list for one copy. That's going to be a little bit of a wait, okay? And if I want to find something, let's see. For a second, yes, I checked out. I want to get a book by an author I like, Celeste Ng, called Everything I Never Told You. And this is an audio, I like to listen to audiobooks in the car, so I'll download this onto my smartphone and then attach it with the auxiliary cable to my car stereo. It's available. I'm going to borrow it, but right now I can listen to it on right here on my in my browser. There's a default to 14 days, but I would change that to 21 days so you have as much time as possible, and it will be taken back from you as automatically at the end of 21 days. There's no renewals. I'm going to borrow it, and I can listen right now in the browser, and so can you along with me, and we can start listening. That was the
one. Lydia is dead, but they don't know this yet.
Okay, and that is the beginning of that novel by Celeste Ng. So that's how Overdrive works. It has both ebooks and audiobooks, really big collection, sometimes some pretty long holds. And Shannon's going to tell you about Cloud Library.
Yeah, so the other ebook and e-audiobook platform that Clackamas County has is called Cloud Library. I don't believe that Multnomah or Washington County have this particular resource. So it is it is unique to the libraries in Clackamas County. It's also much smaller. Clackamas County owns, like purchases and curates the entire inventory here. So it's a lot smaller than Overdrive. And also I've noticed that since the stay at home orders, the server can kind of hiccup a little bit. But what I like about this, about Cloud Library is that it's actually easier to get holds more readily than Libby, but it is a smaller collection. And I don't know if, I think that Chris said this, Libby is Kindle compatible, Cloud Library is not. So if you have a Kindle and that's your reading device, you'll need to use Library to Go, Libby, Overdrive, all the those, that one. It will not work with Cloud Library. We own and curate our collection here. And if we go ahead and scroll down, you just see, back to school, anti-racism, teen books. There's even the OBOB, which I get really excited about. This is the Oregon Battle of the Books. It's a statewide reading competition for grades 3 through 12. And so we have the 2021 OBOB books book titles right there. So that's really nice. I know that all items loan out for 21 days. You can return it early, or it will just disappear when the due date comes. So you don't have to worry about fines. It's really nice. You can borrow up to 6 items at a time, and I believe you can have 6 holds at a time. Holds might vary a little bit, but you can have 6 items out at one time. And it's the same thing Libby, you just download an app onto your device if you want to use it that way. I certainly use it on my phone. Or you can listen in the browser. If you listen in the browser or because I listen to audiobooks, that's why I say listen. It will actually hold your place, and then I can go and listen, start back up on my phone. So that's another nice thing. It automatically bookmarks where you are. So that's really good. So those are the main points about Cloud Library. It's really easy to find. You can, if you want to search and filter, you can search for just audiobooks and just for items that are available now if you don't want to deal with any holds. You're just ready for something now. So that's really nice. So as Chris is demonstrating in the filters, you can click on available now and audiobooks or ebooks if that's your preference. So that's another nice thing there.
And great. And before Shannon talks about one of our magazine databases, RB Digital, I just want to say that when you're searching for downloadable ebooks and audiobooks, you can do that in many different ways. You can search right here in the individual Cloud Library website or the OverDrive website. You can search in Cloud Library on your device, in OverDrive on your device, or you can just go to our catalog and search there for what you want. I like to use Michelle Obama's book, Becoming, because I know it's available in a bunch of different formats. And the catalog will tell you all the different ways you can find this book. So you can see that her book is available as a book, as a large print book, as an audiobook on CDs, which I still like to use in my car because it's just easier for me and I can keep my phone free for phone use, in Spanish, in Mandarin, some other books come in there. Downloadable ebook on OverDrive, and you can, Shannon mentioned Kindle. If you want to have a Kindle edition, you've got to go to OverDrive. Cloud Library doesn't have Kindle, as she said. Downloadable audiobook in OverDrive. Downloadable audiobook in Cloud Library. And then if I turn the page, it's also a downloadable ebook in Cloud Library. So this is the very rare title that's available as both an ebook and an audiobook in both Cloud Library and OverDrive. But you can kind of survey the scene in our catalog if you don't want to search in each platform separately. And now Shannon's going to talk about RB Digital.
Yeah, thank you for showing that, Chris. So RB Digital, this one is a little tricky right now. It was just purchased with OverDrive and it will be dissolved over the next few months. It's a little bit of a moving target. We don't have an exact date just yet, but RB Digital is great for e-magazines, and Link has it and Multnomah County has it. Normally we have about 48 magazine titles. In this, right now we have over 3,000. Some of those are sort of one-off supplemental issues. A lot of them are international titles. So if you're interested in Architectural Digest Italy, you are in luck. We have it. I use this. I purchased for our CD collection at the library, and so I use this to access Rolling Stone so I can read their reviews. So this is just, I mean, sometimes we just don't need a book, we just need magazines, and this is a great resource for that. So you can just check it out. There's no limit to checking out. There's no limit. I think it might be about, actually, I don't know how many days you get it. Is it 21, Chris?
I'm not sure. Sorry.
Yeah, I tend to borrow it and read it right away and then return it. I don't tend to let it linger in my account. You do need to register your device, sign in, create an account. But it's really easy to use. Just check it out, read it then, and if you want to, and then if you're like me, return it right away.
So just so you can see what this looks like, and by the way, it's nice to have a meeting that starts with the Beatles sometimes instead of the national anthem. So thanks for the music, and here's the Beatles again on the cover here. But if I want to read this article or this magazine, I've already created an account in RB Digital. So I sign in, It's checking to make sure that I am a legitimate library user. And now it's checked out and I want to read it right now and you'll see it pop open. And here it is. And I can just turn the pages with these arrows on the right and left. So there's the contents page, continued, and got the ads. So it's really a pretty high resolution just picture of the magazine pages, and you can zoom in and make it bigger. Here's Inside Trump's Battle with Portland, Oregon. What's going on in Portland? this is a nice way to, some people really like to have the print version of a magazine, but if you need your magazine fixed and you don't want paper to be building up in your house, this is a nice way to consume magazines.
And as I said, when I first started, at some point, this information, all these magazines will be in Overdrive. We just don't have an exact date for it right now. So you can find this in our RB Digital, which can be found through the online database pathway on the website.
Okay. I'm going to talk about streaming video and audio now. And for that, I'm going to go to the Multnomah County site because they have two streaming services. The first one I'm going to talk about, Canopy, is available in all three of the metro area counties, Clackamas, Washington, and Multnomah. But Multnomah County also has Hoopla, another one. In general, Multnomah County just has more resources because there's more people and more tax money coming in. So if you don't live in Multnomah County, that's a great reason to get a Multnomah County library card, which you can for free. So under eBooks and More, there's our friend Libby, and here's Canopy. And if you've never used Canopy before, it will prompt you to, I wanted to show you logging in. Yep. It will prompt you to make an account here with add a library card. And the only thing I would say about it is I don't find it super intuitive. It'll ask you for, it needs an email address. And then the next field, it asks you for a password. And it seems like it's asking you for your email password. And of course you should not be giving Canopy or any other company your email password. It's really just asking you to create a discrete or unique password for Canopy. So I'm going to log into my Canopy account here in Multnomah County. I also have one in Clackamas County. You can see my email address if you want to send me any questions. CM Guybrarian. Let's see. And this kind of public typing is very high pressure. Okay, and you see it's very friendly. Welcome back, Chris. It recognizes me. And up in the upper right-hand corner, you can see the number 5, and that means I have 5 play credits left this month. And in Clackamas County, you get 5 on Canopy. In Multnomah County, I think it might be 6, and I've watched a movie this month while prepping for this meeting, so I'm down to 5. And you can see they curate under different themes, so new editions, new documentaries, new world cinema, and then some themes like injustice, filmmakers, things that are trending, psychotherapy, books to screen, and on and on and on. It's a really large and diverse collection of movies. I want to watch something with Cary Grant. So I'm going to put in him as a search, and I get there's a documentary about him, Charade with Audrey Hepburn, Penny Serenade. I want to watch this great screwball comedy, His Girl Friday. And it pops up, and we're just going to go right into the titles. I think I was already watching this. I was already watching it, so it's already in the movie. But if you're like my kids who are 18 and 20 and 22, they would just watch this on their phone because they don't care how big the screen is. The New Yorker is referred to that generation as being platform agnostic. But I like to watch on the biggest screen possible. So you can take your laptop and connect it to your TV monitor with an HDMI cable, or under the support documents down in the Canopy website, you can learn how to connect your Canopy account to your Apple TV account or your Roku or whatever you might have that you get video through. And you can get Canopy kind of partnered with that and watch on your television screen and have a bigger image. So that's Canopy. I'm going to log out. And as I mentioned, Multnomah County is different from Washington and Clackamas, also has Hoopla, which is very similar. It's going to ask you to make an account that's tied to your library card. And I think I'm already logged in. And you can see I've borrowed, they have videos and some fun audio. So I'm a kind of a Hamilton addict. So I have the Hamilton cast recording. I can browse here by movies and music. They have, I think, more kind of popular feature films than Canopy. Canopy's a little more art house. I thought I was going to the music. Hold on. Okay. Here we have Taylor Swift, and we can borrow Taylor Swift's album. Looks like you get it for 7 days. And I can start playing it right now. All right, so for someone of my generation, this is all new and kind of mind-blowing that I can just go listen to basically anything I want on my computer anytime I want. But I still like to go to my local CD store, Music Millennium. I'm going to return that. So if you, again, if you have a Clack or a Multnomah County card, then you have access to Hoopla as well as Canopy. So those are streaming services. I can't see the chat. I don't know if there's any comments. Helen, do you have anybody with comments or questions?
This is funny. I've been enjoying your program so much that I'm not paying attention.
It's fine.
I don't see any questions. No.
All right, we're gonna keep
going. Along. No okay. Questions.
All right, we're going to transition into places that you can find information you might need. And as librarians, we're talking about like curated, authoritative sources that someone's kind of monitoring at all times. And we feel like we can trust these sources. And Shannon's going to start by telling you about Novelist.
So one of my favorite reference sources that I go to is if anyone comes up to me and wants, they just finished a book and they're looking to figure out what to read next, I go to Novelist, which all library systems have and which Chris is taking you to through the link website. Novelist is just a wonderful resource. It offers you author, title, series read-alikes. You can find discussion questions if you're hosting a book group. If you want, you heard about the latest book and you want to read reviews about it or different articles about it. If you're curious about getting into different genres, say either romance or science fiction, fantasy, this is a great place to go. It's a great discovery tool when you're trying to figure out what to read next. So it's very easy to use. So my example is The Vanishing Half. So let's say you just finished reading The Vanishing Half and your mind was blown and you want to read more about that. So go ahead and click on The Vanishing Half. And you can see it gives you a description. It gives you some genres and themes. You go down further, you see reviews right below it. And then on the right side, there's a list of books here. And these books on the right are kind of read-alike. So if you liked The Vanishing Half, you might really like A Kind of Freedom or We Cast a Shadow. If you really want to aggregate, sort of like filter it down further, down at the bottom here, you can search for more. So let's say you really want to explore the theme of facing racism. So we'll click on that. But you really want it in own voices. And by own voices, this huge term that's come up in the last few years of you know, someone who is writing from specifically from that experience. So let's say you want a Black author writing about, you know, facing racism, but go ahead and search that. And it's going to filter out all these different titles that helps you sort of like, these are the themes I want to explore. These are the points of view I want. And so it gives you, you know, The Nickel Boys, just harrowing, Sing, Unburied, Sing, another great one. And then you can further filter it from, because I see some YA, some young adult titles here, which I really feel like everyone should be reading young adult. But if you're just, you know, not interested, you can definitely refine it further to just adult only and fiction versus nonfiction, and just continue to narrow your search down that way. And then you'll find your next favorite book. But if anyone ever talks to me, like they're looking for a read-alike or they're looking for the next title, I always use this service. With your library card, this is for free for you. You just, depending on if you're in Multnomah, Washington County, or libraries in Clackamas County, you can find it in the online databases listings. So it's called Novelist, and I highly recommend it.
Great. Another one of our most popular resources in the library when we're open is Consumer Reports, because we have that, you know, the current issues in of the magazine in print, and we also have their great annual buying guide. But when we're closed, you can still request through our catalog individual editions of the magazine once they're circulating. But you can also use the Consumer Reports version online, which is a very rich resource. We put all of our, in Clackamas County, we've collected all these databases here, and you can search either A to Z and go just to C for Consumer Reports, but we've also clustered them around topics. So academic resources, resources around biography, culture, history. I want to go to consumer and home as a topic. And here's Consumer Reports. It's going to prompt me for my library card, but probably not now because I've logged in so many times today. So it recognizes my computer and knows that I'm a Clackamas County library card holder. So it goes right in, but ordinarily you would be asked for your library card and PIN at that point. And you can search, you can see kind of what things they're pushing up at you, like best deals on new cars. During the course of the pandemic, my oldest son made so many smoothies, protein shakes, that he burnt out the engine on our blender. So we need a new blender. And I'm going to go to the bees, and you can see all the different topics they've clustered here. And here's blenders. And if you're familiar at all with Consumer Reports, this will look familiar to you. They've got ratings for immersion blenders. I don't know what a personal blender is, but there's personal blenders. We need a full-size blender because he's a big guy and he makes big protein shakes. So I'll go to the protein, to the full-size blender ratings, and they're rating 68 different blenders. They start with the highest rated with this performance score of 88 at $550. When I go to Consumer Reports, I like to look for their Best Buy designation, which here is this Ninja for, and it's, I got a smart screen, for $170. That might be more in my wife's and my neighborhood for a new blender. But you can kind of just see all the different prices, all the different ratings, and you can click on an individual model for more details. So that's Consumer Reports. And I think once people know that this is available online, well, then they just like, I don't need to come into the library anymore to get the magazine, because I can search, you know, in a pretty agile way right here on the website. Another thing that's very in demand at the library when we're open is newspapers. And we have our regular patrons who like to come in, and they like to get the crossword puzzle from the New York Times. They like to check the Oregonian and the LO Review and the New York Times and all the other papers that we carry. So they're missing that right now, but there are great newspaper resources on your library's homepages. I'm going to go to Multnomah County again for this. As I mentioned, Multnomah County has by far the largest collection of databases, including newspapers. So they put it into a long alphabetical list, but you could narrow it down over here if you want to and get to a smaller list of resources. As we go down, I'll just show you. They have, for example, the Los Angeles Times available, the New York Times, both current and historical. They have America's News Newsbank, which is more historical newspapers. And then they have the entire run of the Oregonian, but they try to, this is a little tricky because they've split it in the historical part, 1861 to 1987 is here under H for historical. And then the current run is 1987 to the present is under O for Oregonian. And right above it, you can see the Oregon Journal, the old afternoon paper of my youth. So if I want to search, if you've ever used OregonLive.com and tried to find anything, you know, before today's news, it's so frustrating. So this is a much better curated way to access the Oregonian. So here, when you click, they're going to ask you for your library card number and your PIN. I think they actually are going, oh, no, they let me right in because I've already logged in today. So I'm really interested in, you know, update on the Black Lives Matter protests in Portland. So that's going to bring up a lot of results. And here you can see my results. I'm going to make them a little bigger so you can see them. You can see that they are absolutely up to date. So this is an editorial or opinion piece in today's Oregonian. And then a related news piece, and you can just keep going back. And you can obviously refine your search if you want to focus just on like Ted Wheeler's response or violence or the Danielson killing. Narrow down your search that way. Lots and lots of newspapers available to you full text in the in your library's database collections. And Shannon's going to talk about genealogy now.
Yeah, so one of probably the most popular research topic is genealogy, and all library systems have a dedicated page for this subject. The most popular or most used resource is ancestry.com. It is a subscription-based resource, so definitely check, and most library systems should have it, so definitely check your library system to see if you have access to it. Remote access to Ancestry has been temporarily expanded during the pandemic, so definitely, again, check your location to see if that is the case for your home library. Ancestry.com just contains such a wealth of information, from census records to birth, marriage, death records, immigration and travel. I know that they're expanding their military and international records. And it's really quite easy to use. So as Chris is demonstrating, you just enter in the name, if you want it exact, make it exact, and then scroll through, and looks like there's the 1920 census 100 years ago. So hopefully you've all been participating with your 2020 census. So you know, in 100 years, we could your descendants can find you.
This is my maternal grandmother at age 3 in Kenosha, Wisconsin. Pretty cool.
Wow, that's very cool. Anyway, so another great resource if you're doing in your genealogical search is Heritage Quest, which I know for certain Multnomah County has. It's limited availability, so definitely check your library's homepage for more information. I know that with Clackamas County, only Wilsonville has it, so you have to be, your home library has to be Wilsonville for you to use that, but Multnomah County does have it as well. So
And you might have noticed Wilsonville listed in the Clackamas County up here, and that's because they are coordinating the Clackamas County account. So it somehow just defaults to that, but you're it doesn't really matter if you're in Lake Oswego or wherever you're coming from in Clackamas County, it's going to show Wilsonville Public Library.
So definitely, again, as we said earlier, take a look at your home library page. Like I said, most of them, if genealogy is your thing, most of them have a dedicated genealogy page, and it'll give you tips on how to search. And ancestry.com is fantastic.
And we're going to move on now to just the catch-all category of other things your library offers that you may not be aware of or that you may not be taking full advantage of. And we want you to use these resources, and Shannon's going to talk about cultural passes.
Yeah, so I highly recommend if you have a library card in one of these library systems, they have cultural passes, and it's basically an agreement with the library and the cultural venues around the Willamette Valley. Each one is a little bit different in what they offer, but it's a great way to explore. Like, so Clackamas County has passes. These are limited, these are free to reduced rate admission to, say, the Oregon Garden, Oregon Historical Society, the Pittock Mansion. It's just a great way to explore what you have around you at a discounted rate, and you get this with your library card, and it's a great way to spend a holiday weekend, perhaps. So I know that Washington County, I believe their Cultural Pass to Adventure program has been suspended until further notice, so definitely take a look at your homepage to see what is offered and what's available, but it's absolutely worth it with your library card. Another notable service, I'm personally involved with this at the Lake Oswego Library, is our homebound services. And all library systems have some form, whether it's by physical delivery or by mail, but it's getting books to our community members who are homebound for whatever reason. And if they are not, you know, accustomed to using online resources, or they just need the library to come to them, that is an option. And so definitely check the web pages to see for more information. But it's a great way to make sure the library, everyone has access to the library, no matter what your circumstances are.
And if you're looking for something fun to do, like you just need a little more human connection during these strange times, we've kind of collected those things under this site, Remote Lake Oswego Public Library. And so we have online learning group, postcards from your librarians. We've got some different book clubs. I run a trivia contest with one of my colleagues every Thursday night at 7. It's super fun and free, and like a good movie, it only lasts 90 minutes. So then you can move on with your Thursday evening. But we also have let me get to the book clubs here. If you're interested in discussion groups around books, there's a Building Bridges book group around different issues of things like empathy and getting to know people better. And then Shannon and a colleague help do a weekly Cook the Books book group, where they talk about recipes and food and cookbooks. And then Shannon, as she mentioned, founded with another colleague whose name is also Shannon, so the two awesome Shannons, founded a Bookish Affair, this romance book club. And I've read and the books and gone to several of their meetings in these 7 or 8 months that they've had this. And I just want to tell you, if you want to cheer up during the pandemic, read a romance novel. They're really, really fun, and they're woman-centered, and one of the conventions of the genre is that they have a happy ending. So,
who doesn't need that right now?
We all need a happy ending, and it's guaranteed in a romance novel. So They're just really fun. And the two Shannons do such a great job of picking great romance novels, and it's such a huge field. I want to close with just something fun. We mentioned mouse around your library's homepage and see what is there. We've shown you a lot of things in the Like Us We Go homepage. And just one more, we have a very rich collection of online local history resources, and it's under Books and More. And you can see also here, there's those cultural past expressors in the book, the discussion groups. And then our Library of Things, which is really fun. And then the local history, we have a historic photo database if you're only interested in photos, but also most of that's been migrating now to this larger collection, the Digital Archive. And the sweep and breadth of things here is really astonishing. But just as one example, I'm interested in researching, I'm a basketball fan, and I want to know about Kevin Love, a famous Lake Oswegan who's now in the NBA. And if I search for him, then I learn that all the Lake Oswego High School and Lake Ridge yearbooks, basically from the entire histories of the two schools, are digitized here in our collection. And so I can go to the 2006 Lake Ridge High School yearbook, which is here, and I can go to page 160. Sorry. And I can find this Jughead right here, Kevin Love, as a 17-year-old before he went to UCLA and started getting really rich in the NBA. So just, if you have friends who went to high school in Lake Costa Rica, you can look them up. But also there's lots of really interesting historical documents and photos in there too. So that wraps up our part of the presentation, and we'd love to answer any questions that you have.
Yes, and we have some.
Great. I'm going to stop sharing my screen.
Okay. Here. So let me start with, there was a question from Jamelia. Please clarify which library systems have RB Digital? What would that be, RB?
RB Digital, yes. Yeah. That would be Multnomah County and Clackamas County.
Clackamas County.
For now.
And, yeah.
You know, you encourage people to get library books or library cards. Do they just log on and request a library card? Is that how they get a library card now?
So there are a lot of, yeah, most of them have online card applications, mm-hmm. and it's very immediate, and they all come with conditions, so definitely read the fine print there.
Okay.
I know with Clackamas County, because I can only speak for Clackamas County, you can apply for an online card and you have immediate usage of your online databases and ebook access, but if you want to get a full operational card, 80 items checkout limit, 40 limit hold, you do need to then physically come into to our curbside, and we can complete and get you even, a physical card.
So even now, you could get a physical card.
Correct.
I have to go. Okay. I know I've got one, Multnomah County and Lake Oswego, it would be Clackamas. And if they both work perfectly. Okay.
Yeah.
Question from Carl. What are the limits in terms of products available to people from out of area? For instance, I could not log on to the RB Digital from Clackamas. Same, I think, with Hoopla at Fort Vancouver.
Chris, do you want this one?
Yeah, I think the limits are that you need to have an account in that system to use their resources. And I would add that you can't just go to Google and Google for Canopy and go to Canopy's website. You have to go through the web page of the library system in question. So if you want to log into Multnomah County's Canopy account because you have a Multnomah County Library card, go to the Multnomah County Library website, click on eBooks and More, click on Canopy, and that takes you to Multnomah County's portal for Canopy that will recognize you as a Multnomah County patron. And that's true. That's basically true across all the different databases, that you can't just go to newyorktimes.com and log in with your library card number. You've got to go through the library's webpage. And I'm not sure about the problem with the RB Digital login. I would just try it again. And if you're having trouble, then call the reference line and we can try to sort it out. Sometimes if you haven't used your library card in a long, long time, you've gone inactive as a patron and you need to get reactivated.
Because there was a comment from Sharon Joy that it looks like Washington, I'm not sure if it's Vancouver, Washington or Washington County, discontinued her card for interlibrary loan. So she may have just not used it in a while.
Yes.
And needs to reactivate. Correct. Okay, thank you. Ingrid just says, what a fun presentation. You're all enjoying it. I really had to be engaged through this whole thing.
Thank you.
My sweet husband here has a question. I'm going to go get rid of the background for a minute.
He's coming out of the trees now.
Yes.
Okay.
There you go.
Yeah,
I
was interested that your search exclude juvenile and young adult. That's great, because when I try to buy books, you can't do that on the bookstore lists. And so you're good on that. But there's another thing that they don't have on the bookstore list. I'd like to ask you about as a possibility for libraries to actually do this. You have the fiction and nonfiction category, but when you select nonfiction, lots of times you get, particularly I look for philosophy books, and if you select philosophy and nonfiction, you get all kinds of religious content, which is based on divine revelation, which you couldn't presume that it's fiction, but you shouldn't presume that it's nonfiction either. And so there's got to be a third category. How do you treat that kind of stuff? Let me exclude that, because I don't want to get buried in my search results with all this religious stuff when we mostly don't believe in divine revelations.
No, I understand. You guys are the humanists. But another hot tip I would have added as number six is whenever you can use advanced search in any database or any catalog. And for example, Multnomah County makes it really hard to use advanced search, but if you can find the advanced search interface, and I use it on Google all the time, then you can use Boolean search terms like and, or, and not. And so you could, in your case, search for philosophy, not religion, and see what you bring up. The other thing I would suggest as a strategy is, if you're looking for a lot of philosophy books, you find one that's really the kind of book you're looking for, go into the record of that book, and there are Library of Congress subject headings assigned to it, and one of them will say, you know, philosophy or metaphysics or whatever you're interested in. Click on that subject heading, and that'll bring up all the books that get that subject heading, and it will exclude the ones that might be a little farther afield. So there's different ways to narrow it down, but yeah, advanced search when you can find it. A lot of catalogs, and certainly like Amazon, make it really hard to use advanced search because they want you to see more stuff and more products rather than less. And Google wants you to look at everything and all the ads and things like that. So the more you can like narrow things down, it's good.
Thank you. Comment from Carl that he does have a library card from those libraries. Carl, did you want to make any another question that I'm not getting detailed enough when? Are we okay? I know he's silent. Okay. Polly writes, I have Washington County, Clark County, Clackamas, and Multnomah cards. I got them a long time ago. I had to reactivate cards before. She's had to reactivate. A question from Ingrid. Do you know anything about Marion County Library System and what they have to offer?
Shannon, do you know anything about Marion County? I don't know. But I mean, what I do know is that all these libraries are parts of larger systems. I think Shannon froze up. But so the Salem Public Library is part of a larger system down there, south of us in the Willamette Valley. So they're combining resources, and hopefully they have a pretty good collection of materials too.
I have just a question. If I was getting on, I know you're recommending you know, get on and just have some time and search and play with the home pages. But say you get lost and like, boy, I really wanted to do that. Calling the research librarian, is that a legit thing to do?
Absolutely. And because that's what we're there for. And we really want to help you use the resources as well and fully as you can. So, and the only caveat I would add is like, sometimes it's, you know, with devices and when we're on the phone and we can't see your screen, it's a little hard for us to coach you through that, but we'll do our best. Mm-hmm. But in the case of like, if you live anywhere near LO and you can come by our tent, you know, we try to keep some distance because of the pandemic, but it's a little easier for us to help in person with a device.
Okay. You could bring, if you had a, like a laptop, you could bring the laptop.
Yeah, you could bring your laptop or your smartphone or your iPad. Yeah. And we, you know, we have to, we're trying to keep like 6 feet between us. And so that makes it a little more challenging, but it's definitely.
Yeah. You could turn it or just, you can talk. Great. Carl had a suggestion. There is an add-on to Foxfire called Library that will do a search at all libraries you belong to and give you availability.
Yeah, that's a cool thing. So if you, yeah, if you use Firefox and you feel comfortable doing that, yeah, mm-hmm. then you can, it's that's really awesome. Then you can see across all the different systems at once. And that's a fun thing to do because you, like if there's a really hot book, and it's got a super long hold list in Multnomah County, which just has more people.
Sure.
It might have a shorter hold list in Clackamas or Washington. So it's fun to be able to look at a glance and see those.
Ale had another question.
Is Shannon here? Did she come back? Shannon?
Yeah, I temporarily lost
connection. Okay, sorry, I'm hogging the. Yeah.
No, you're good.
Hang on, he's gotta think.
I've been using the trying to use the pick up the real physical books from the Multnomah County Library, and I reserved some books in early June. I think I just reserved one book in early June, and they didn't come out till late July where I could actually pick it up. And at that time, the librarian encouraged me to put more in when I was actually there, and I put in a bunch more, three or four more. And their system's absolutely not moving. I mean, it's so backed up. I feel like I don't want to be in the queue and blocking all the other people who maybe have more need for these books than I do. And so you say they have more resources than anybody else. Does that mean that all these library systems, if you're actually looking for physical books, that the process is something that they're not really prepared to do on the scale that people are expecting them to do it, and that we should go easy on it, let them serve the people who need it the most? And I got one other question too, I guess I'll ask you later on maybe.
Well, there's definitely kind of a bottleneck right now, material, like, so at the beginning all library systems extended everyone's due dates at least several times. And now we have to put items in quarantine for up to 6 days, depending on who. And then you just hope that the hold request list doesn't exceed 1,000 items. So there's just, there's so much going on. There's so much moving. There's so many different moving parts. So yes, patience is required. I wouldn't relinquish your holds just yet, unless you really just don't need the titles. We're moving as quickly as we can. And I know that I can place an item on hold, even if I'm fairly certain it's available at Lake Oswego. And I'll still probably wait at least a week for it to be made available to me to then schedule that pickup.
Well, so you know, I've been
in parts right now.
I put in a book hold on, that's right. I've had one book on hold since June the 8th. Multnomah County, when I went to the online, said it was available right then. And it's still on hold from June 8th. So I'm not going after the common titles. You know, I'm an oddball guy.
And, yeah, no, And I imagine, I mean, Multnomah County is going through a lot of restructuring right now. Right. So I don't know how their hold systems work. I do know that even like at the best of times, it was a little bit slower than what I would experience with Clackamas County. Right. Mm-hmm. Cause I know that they don't pull a hold request list every day. But certainly I don't know how many people they have in each building or if all, libraries are all branches are open right now. So it's definitely on the slower side right now.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you about one other thing. There's a science study came out this week that showed that I think it was just 1 or 2 hours of computer use per day by children correlates pretty highly with less reading ability. And if you think that computer use for the library doesn't fit that pattern, do you have an exception? Are you an exception? And if so, why?
Well, I'll take a swing at that. But no, I wouldn't make an exception for library use. I think small children should be having books read to them by their parents. And
well, this was around, I think, was ages 8 to 10.
Well, they should be reading books themselves. And
Yeah.
Yeah. And I know like right now that's a challenge because it's hard to get books, but I think screen time is, it's a national epidemic. And so including for all of us, the reason I don't ever want to read an ebook is because I already look at a screen enough times and it's so relaxing and pleasurable to me to look at print on paper. It's somehow just like, it's easier on me and ergonomically more satisfying. It's just nice. So, it's a bad time to be saying this, but we should all be spending less time on a screen. It's hard.
Yeah, screen fatigue is pretty high right now.
It's true. Yeah. We've been doing this for 6-7 months now.
Yeah, it's really bad.
That brings me to a question. You know, I see meetings changing with COVID. I see the future of meetings changing, that there'll be more Zoom meetings even when COVID is long gone. How do you see the future of libraries when things get back to normal? Say, I'm just going to say 2 years from now. I think COVID will be long gone by then for sure. How do you see the future of libraries with more electronics?
Shannon, do you want to say? I'm happy to talk about that.
Go for it.
Yeah, now I'm hearing like maybe we'll have a widespread vaccine by July of 2021, but we're in this for the long haul. But I think when we get back to library buildings being open, mm-hmm. they're still going to fill this role that has nothing to do with electronics or technology, which is that they are a place where people can go mm-hmm. for free and hang out and use the restroom and see their neighbors or see other people from their town or neighborhood. And so I think that's a part of the public library service that's really, really being missed right now by people who, are less advantaged than probably all of us on this phone call. And so if anything, it's kind of highlighted that's a critical role that public libraries play. So I think we'll keep doing that. It's changed the way, maybe some of my colleagues will work more from home and things like that, but we're still, the demand for people miss their print books too. So it's highlighted the fact that people, especially like from my age on up, really still like to read an actual book. So I'm kind of old school that way. I don't think the public library is gonna go anywhere. And,
No, it really fits a social and connective piece of the community. And people have talked about, where we'll go, for the last however many years that technology has really been more integrated into our daily life. And I don't see us going. I think we're very much part of the community. So. Yes.
And I would add that in the area of technology, libraries play a really important role for people who either can't afford good Wi-Fi and a good computer, or just can't figure it out. And so Wi-Fi, a desktop computer, and the capability of printing is something that public libraries in the last like 15 years have really helped a lot of people by providing, you know, for free.
Yes. Yeah, that access to computers, to printing, to Wi-Fi, that it's actually pretty expensive, and it's don't always have access to that. So.
Yeah, yes. I just having been a library patron all my life, I just want to honor the work that you both do, and thank you so sincerely for hanging in there with us, you know, and just being a lifeline to books and music and movies, and you've helped a lot. And even though we're sorrowful that we can't go in, you know, we can't go visit, it means a lot. It means so much, the work that you do.
Thank you. And I'm just noticing you. Sharon's comment. And
sorry. You're right. That's a new one. Go ahead.
Thank you, Sharon. I agree with you that libraries are a kind of paradise. It's a lovely thought. And just, I think and you mentioned journalists in the post office too. I think anything right now for certain parts of our population, anything that embodies those things you mentioned in your kind of mission statement, science, reason, and free inquiry, is under attack by some parts of the national population, and it's unfortunate. And libraries are clearly part of that, but hopefully we can, you know, supported by citizens of good intent, and we can continue to be a strong part of the community.
Go ahead.
I don't mean to get really cheesy, but I think back to the movie, Emilio Estevez's movie, The Public, which is about a public library system in, I think it's Cleveland, Ohio. And the director says libraries are one of the last democratic places in America. And that really has resonated with me. It's really like anyone can go, it doesn't matter what class you're in, it doesn't matter what your annual income is, it doesn't matter, you know, color of your skin, it doesn't matter where you're from, like you can come in and use this space and be welcomed, and you have equal access for all. So I just think of that as, like, you know, as we're moving through these times, and, you know, journalism is under attack and all this other stuff, I just go back to this mission of public libraries. Like, we're that safe space, or we try to be.
Yeah. And I just want to read Sharon's comment, but just make sure everybody hears it. If journalists and post offices are under attack, are libraries too? Libraries are an example of a paradise people can create. Thank you, Sharon. That is such lovely.
Okay, we appreciate you being here today, and by the number of participants we had today, I think it was a very good topic and very timely. And we'd like to present both of you with an HGP mug that we'll be sending to you in the next few days from the post office. It may take a while, but...
But we support the post office.
That's right.
Thank you. I love mugs. That's going to be really going to enjoy that. I can see it meets my criteria. It's got a big handle that I can get, you know, more than two fingers through. So thank you very much.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Love it.
Oh, and one last thing. There is a board meeting today, if anybody wants to attend, at 11:45. And that was sent out through the HTTP mail system. So everybody should have an invitation if they'd like to attend.
Thank you.
I just want to say that Wayne is a dead ringer for William Stafford, who is the kind of patron saint of the Lake Oswego Public Library.
That's right.
Famous Oregon poet. So that's nice to see you there, Wayne.
Oh, no problem.
You know, I just am seeing, I think, an important question from Joyce, and she wondered, are libraries still sharing music and art? I know they were sharing pieces of art, I think, that people could take home. Am I wrong on that?
We don't have a, like, I think some libraries do have art that you can check out. We've had a very long-standing monthly concerts, one on the evening of the first Tuesday and one on the afternoon of the second Wednesday. And we've been live streaming those the last few months, but friends of the library who fund that are running out of money because their used bookstore has been closed for 5 months. But So we're going to suspend at least the first Tuesday music for a while, but I do think other libraries are live streaming concerts and other cultural events. And so, and that bookstore has now gone online at thebooktique.org. If you need some books, they've cataloged 10,000 books online. You can buy their used books online.
And they'll mail them to the house?
I guess so, yeah.
Wow, okay, that's good. Thank you.